Do you just want me to start? Okay. Welcome back. I'm Janine Treese. I'm the Assistant U.S. Trustee in the Northern District of Georgia. Before I begin talking, I'm always required, as all program Department of Justice employees are required to say, the statements I make today are my own and not necessarily the position of the Department of Justice or U.S. Trustee. I am going to be talking about the role of the U.S. Trustee and generally how subclients work statistics. Government employees love our statistics. But before I begin, I wanted to comment a little bit about some statements that Tom and Rob made about consulting with the U.S. Trustee, which we love that they consult with U.S. Trustee and we do consult with them, and that is appropriate. But I did want to say that the U.S. Trustee publishes guidelines for trustees. There's a handbook, it's a public document, it's on our website that tells trustees what to do and what not to do. But we don't dictate to the trustees, you do this in this case. They are independent of us. But we are part of the executive branch, and so our duty is to, enforce laws. And the program is very committed to the success of the SBRA. And our manual, trustees handbook, says that we are not to initiate roadblocks or hurdles that might impair debtors' abilities to successfully reorganize. And so sometimes that's one of the reasons the trustees are asked to consult with us, so we can make sure that there's not some unnecessary action that's going to extend or expand the cost of reorganization or impair the debtors' abilities. The U.S. Trustee, as I've mentioned, undertakes extensive efforts to make the SBRA a success. And this first slide lists the major administrative duties of the U.S. Trustee, which predominantly involve recruitment and appointment of trustees and selection of a trustee in a particular case, scheduling and convening the IDI in the 341 meeting, and basically ensuring everybody plays by the rules to fulfill their obligations in the case. In the Northern District of Georgia, we have six trustees and the pool of trustees. Prior to the enactment or the effective date of the SBRA, we were required to appoint pools of trustees who will be appointed on a case-by-case basis to the Subchapter 5 cases when they are filed. When a Sub-5 case is filed here in the Northern District of Georgia, the clerk, the U.S. Trustee receives an automated email with a new case name and case number and pre-look of the petition. And we immediately begin the process of selecting a trustee. And the reason we need to do that immediately is because the clerk of court is waiting on us for that information, because that information is part of what is required to be included in the notice of commencement of the case that goes out to all creditors. So we really very quickly go about the process of selecting a trustee and then selecting the 341 meeting date. We do that by reviewing the petition. We review publicly available materials. And we also send out an email to the debtor's attorney asking about the reasons for the filing of the case, some information about the debtor's business, some issues that may be occurring in the case, and we use that information to pair the case with a trustee whose skills and experiences most well match the case, as Todd mentioned earlier. So if it's a case that involves tax issues or accounting problems, or if it's a small business, a real small business, we might select a trustee who's got more experience working in small businesses. If there's sophisticated, complex litigation, we would maybe turn to a different member. Once we've selected the person who is best suited for the case, we contact that person and we determine their suitability for appointment. And to do that, we ask about their connections with parties of interest. We ask about whether they're immediately available to meet with the debtor and the debtor's attorney by phone. We ask whether they're immediately available to complete and return a verified statement of their disinterestedness. We ask about whether they're going to be available for first day hearings, the IDI, 341 meeting, the staff's conference. These are all things that the trustees are required to attend, and certainly we don't want to appoint someone who's going to be on vacation at that time. After that, we notify the clerk about the selection of the trustee and the 341 date, and we file a notice of appointment of the trustee attaching the verified statement that the trustee has filed or the trustee has prepared. That also discloses their hourly rate for the compensation. We endeavor to file this statement on the same day the case is filed or within 24 hours after the case is filed. Because cases are on a fast track, we conduct the IDI within 10 days after the case is filed, and we convene the 341 meeting around 24 days after the case is filed. In the Northern District of Georgia, resets have to be approved by me, and that approval is given only in exceptional circumstances. So please, when you're filing a case, be mindful of the fact that within about 10 days, you and your client are going to need to appear for an IDI, and in about 24 days, you're going to need to appear for the 341 meeting. Because these cases are on fast track, we really don't want to be continuing to extend those things. It's really critical, as some five trustees mentioned a while ago, for debtors to produce materials for the IDI. There's a standard set of documents that we request in every single case. There are no surprises. Honestly, the debtors and their attorneys should be gathering and reviewing these materials before the petition is filed, and then they should promptly produce the materials we requested. It's not happening right here in the Northern District of Georgia, and it's very disappointing. The U.S. Trustee publishes operating guidelines and reporting requirements. The guidelines are an important facet of our efforts to supervise the administration of cases. Attorneys should always review the guidelines with their client. The guidelines for Region 21 were updated in October, so just a few months ago. Please make sure you're providing your client with the current version of the guidelines, which are available on our website. And please note that there are portions of the guidelines and reporting requirements that don't apply to sub 5 cases. And there's a list at the end of the guidelines of the things that do not apply. We are also responsible for ensuring that the debtor files monthly operating reports. And as a reminder, reports in sub 5 cases are submitted on official form 425C. Prior to the mandatory status conference, the U.S. Trustee's attorney will confer with the U.S. Trustee's auditor and with the sub 5 trustee to identify any deficiencies in the case and anything else that needs to be brought to the court's attention, such as failure to submit IDI materials, delinquent operating reports, lapsed insurance, or failure to cooperate with the sub 5 trustee. As will be stated many times throughout this seminar, the legislative purpose of the SBRA is to provide a fast track for a small business to confirm a consensual plan with the assistance of a sub 5 trustee. The program's manual instructs field offices that we are not to take actions in a sub 5 case without first consulting with a sub 5 trustee, because we want to ensure that we're not frustrating the sub 5 trustee's ability to facilitate a consensual plan. This is especially true during the first 90 days of the case. Also, we're just not allowed to unduly frustrate the debtor's implementation of a consensual plan. But this does not mean we're not monitoring the cases, and it doesn't mean that we won't take appropriate action when a debtor's not fulfilling its fiduciary duties. But we always have to be mindful of the goals of allowing the debtor to negotiate a successful plan and not incur unnecessary procedural burdens. Now, the program's data reflects that more than 4,400 debtors have elected to proceed under Subchapter 5. These Subchapter 5 cases have been confirmed at twice the rate and dismissed at half the rate of other small business cases. In addition, the median time to confirmation has been four months faster for Sub 5 cases than for other small business cases, and approximately 70% of confirmed plans in these Sub 5 cases have been consensual. Rob, do y'all have any suggestions for improving the consultation process?
Rob, you start?
Reporting tax returns, that's the death knell in cases. The tax returns aren't being timely. They have not been timely filed, or they're slow in getting them filed. That should be the death of the case. That's the monthly option.
part of that is just, again, back to preparing the client ahead of time to know you're going to have reporting requirements. To report to not complicated, especially in some libraries, it's pretty simple. They're made to be filled out by the client.
They're simple enough, but we've got lots of times there's difficulty in getting them done. I'm seeing that as a problem in some cases, and it's usually the case where they end up getting dismissed.
Before you file bankruptcy cases or your due diligence, check for UCCs. Don't rely on your client to know accurately who has a lien, who doesn't, and what the various priorities are. The last thing you want to do is walk into a case and say, hey, I've got no secured debt, I've got no cash collateral problems, we can just go straight to a plan. We're going to skip all this fight. And then have someone walk in after you've been spending money for a couple of months without court authority and say, oh, by the way, here's my UCC, it's public record, why didn't you contact me? Don't let surprises that you can avoid catch up to you. Know what it is that you're dealing with before you get into it, and don't rely on your client to tell you. You're playing defense. You should be spending your time trying to get a plan confirmed and negotiating with creditors, and now you're having to backpedal and defend yourself as why you didn't do this, why you didn't that, and you start to have to argue about remedies for the situation, where had it been done in advance, you wouldn't have had to spend all this time fixing it.
And I review every case at the outset, right after I'm appointed. The first things I do is lead check to head issues like that off the pass. And I had a case like that where Department of Revenue wasn't listed, but you can check GSCCCA, you can see the tax in several quarters of unfiled payroll tax returns. So it's something that I try to do. It's the debtor should be doing it as well, or just to move the case along. I will check that and I'll bring up the debtor. We've got a new address and I'll list the prior interest in the case.
I wanted to amplify Janine's remark a little bit about the way they select trustees and to point out, as part of your pre-filing protocol, you really, I think, tell me if I'm wrong, reach out to the U.S. trustee, meaning call the U.S. trustee's office and say, we're about to file a sub 5 case. And here's what the issues are, and give a preview of what's about to happen. Because, as she just indicated, they're under the gun because we, the court, put them under a gun so we can promptly get out the notice of commencement of the case. And there's a lot of stuff that needs to happen. So the more time that they have to consider this, the better off probably the case is going to be. And you have established some rapport with the U.S. Trustee's office with regard to your case and shown that you are a responsible person who is in the case.
Yep.
Am I right, Al?
Yes. It's a standard questionnaire that we send out in every case. And sometimes I can tell people have already prepared it because they've filed more than one case and they know what the questions are and they've already prepared their response. And so I get it back just like that. But I would say, please take the time to really give us the information. Not just some short shrift answers, but some meaningful, substantive information about the debtor, and again, what the debtor hopes to achieve in the case, what the hot button issues are, what are the possible pitfalls in the case, because we really do meet as a group and try to pair that case up with the best suitable trustee. And so it really is an important task, and we really appreciate you taking some time, putting some thought into it, and getting it back to us probably. There are some cases where
And if you're really on top of your case, you know that questionnaire is coming. Fill the questionnaire out before you file the case, and either before you file the case or at the same time you file the case, email it over and say, we've just filed the case, here's our questionnaire. No extra charge.
All right. That was it for that section. I think my next section is talking about compensation. Professionals and the sub 5 trustee. And before I begin talking about compensation, one of the things I wanted to talk about was the role of self-appointed trustees. The U.S. trustee doesn't appoint trustees just to appoint a person called a trustee. We appoint a trustee because that person has duties in the case. They have responsibilities. We expect them to play an active role in the case, as we do every trustee that's appointed, whether it's a standing trustee or a panel trustee or a case trustee. They're not to be on the sidelines just waiting for someone to call upon them. They are there to be called upon, but they are expected to play an active role in the case. We tell them they shouldn't be, you know, debtor's attorney shouldn't be waiting them all. No, I don't need you. So you don't have that. That's not your call. You know, it's they have a job to do. And for that job, they should be compensated. And so it's another non-surprise for your client. Let them know there's going to be this person called a trustee. Here's what their duties are. And by the way, they get compensated, and you have to pay for that. So again, surprises are bad. So anyway, I just want to start out with that. The SBRA excludes sub 5 trustees from Section 326, which is the section that usually governs compensation of trustees based on disbursements. U.S. trustees' position is that trustees under sub 5 are compensated under Section 330, which is the same section that governs compensation of debtors' attorneys, and it's reasonable compensation for actual necessary services. And the provisions of Section 330 apply to trustees whether or not they disburse estate funds. In cases with consensual plans, the trustee services end at the time of substantial consummation of the plan, and the trustee can then collect his compensation. Administrative expenses, including the trustees without compensation, should be paid in cash in full on the effective date of the plan, unless some other provision has been agreed to. For cases with non-consensual plans, the trustee remains in place, and the trustee's compensation can be paid over time through the plan. For sub-trustee, 5 trustees are going to be paid only if there are funds on hand, and that's a big issue in a lot of these cases. So we have made attempts to address this. And so in some cases, a provision may be made for reasonable retainers or advance payments during the case to ensure when it comes time to pay the trustee, there will be funds on hand. This can especially be a problem if the debtor's case is dismissed or if the debtor's determined to be ineligible to proceed under sub 5. The U.S. trustee has published parameters for retainers and advance payments, and I've listed them up here on this slide. First, the retainer or payment should be approved by the court or by a local board. For example, the debtor could have include a provision for anticipated fees in the cash collateral budget and order, or pay the fees as a condition to dismissing the case. Second, the retainer or advance payment should not be an amount that adversely affects the debtor's cash flow or its ability to reorganize. Third, retainers should not be drawn down by the trustee without court approval and should be deposited into a trust account and maintain their status as property of the estate. Fourth, the trustee retainer or advance payment should not keep the debtor from paying administrative expenses over time in the case of a non-consensual claim. In adjudging the amount of reasonable compensation, the court considers the nature, extent, and value of the services. The court takes into account all relevant factors, including the time spent, the rates charged, whether the services were necessary or beneficial at the time rendered, whether the services were performed within a reasonable full amount of time, whether the compensation is reasonable based on customary compensation charged by competently skilled practitioners, and the results obtained. Courts have an independent duty to examine fee applications, and they have very broad discretion to award or deny sub-5 trustee fees or professional fees. As a reminder, under Section 330, the court must disallow compensation for unnecessary duplication of services, services that were not reasonably likely to benefit the debtor's estate, and services that were not necessary to the administration of the case. For example, in the Jordan case, Judge Massey disallowed most of the $22,000 fee charged by an attorney who filed a Chapter 11 case that the court determined was doomed from the outset and should never have been filed under Chapter 11. I believe Judge Massey ended up allowing. In the I don't know if this is one of the cases, the citation up there, but in the Near West Coast Inc. case, the court disallowed all of the attorney's compensation for two reasons. First, the court determined that the law firm represented an interest adverse to the estate during the term of its employment. Specifically, the law firm represented the debtor's sole shareholder, who was also a co-debtor and guarantor debtor and co-defendant in a class action lawsuit. The connection was not disclosed in the employment application, nor was it disclosed promptly after it was raised by a creditor in the Subchapter 5 trustee. Second, the court ruled that the law firm was not entitled to compensation from the estate for any period after the debtor was removed as a debtor in possession pursuant to the Supreme Court decision. The applicant bears the burden of proving it is entitled to the requested compensation. This burden should not be taken lightly, especially given that every dollar expended on legal fees is one less dollar that's available for creditors or for the debtor to use. To satisfy its burden, the applicant must justify its charges with itemized billing statements describing each task in detail. Applicants should also provide a narrative report discussing the status of the case and describing counsel's efforts and the results obtained. The detailed billing statements establish your actual time, and the narrative explains how and why the services were rendered and establishes the necessity and benefit of the services. So they're both key elements of application. Also, fee applications must stand on their own. Court and parties are not required to scour the record for justification of awarding compensation. Here are a few rules of thumb to avoid U.S. trustee objections to your fee applications. First, services should be accurately reported in tenth of an hour increments, and multiple tasks should not be lumped together into a single time interval. Second, applications must provide sufficient description of each task performed so that the court and parties can discern the nature, extent, and value of the task and determine whether the time expended was reasonable. If the time entry is too vague or insufficient to allow a fair evaluation by a third party, the court should disallow the compensation. Third, tasks should be billed at an appropriate hourly rate, as determined by the level and skill reasonably required for that particular task. Fees should be reduced if the task could have been performed by someone who is less experienced in the legal cost of the estate. Fourth, the applicant bears the burden to justify the need for multiple professionals attending court hearings, meetings, and telephone conferences. Where there are multiple attendees, the application should explain the need for multiple attendees and should identify each participant's specific role. Finally, applicants should exercise good judgment. Just because the firm's lawyer expended time does not mean it should be billed to the estate. For example, in the Department Industries case, the court determined the amount of time spent drafting a yet-to-be-filed sub-5 plan is excessive, especially given that the plan for sub-5 cases is a form. Likewise, in the Clear the Way Supportive Housing case, the court determined that 10.45 hours spent drafting a disclosure statement in a sub-5 case is unnecessary and should not be compensated. Any expense for which reimbursement is sought must be actually necessary and supported by documentation. The U.S. trustee will consider the following factors. First, whether the expense is reasonable and economical. Second, whether the applicant has provided a detailed itemization, including the date incurred, description of the expense, method of computation, such as per-page cost of photocopies, and, if relevant, the name of the person who incurred the expense and the purpose of the expense. Third, we consider whether the applicant has prorated expenses where appropriate between the estate and other related cases, and has explained the basis for any proration. Fourth, we consider whether expenses incurred by the applicant to third parties are limited to the actual amounts billed. Fifth, whether the applicant can demonstrate that the amount requested for expenses incurred for in-house items reflect the actual cost of expenses to the applicant. Remember Judge Murphy's admonition that photocopying should not be a profit center for the law firm. Sixth, we consider, please keep in mind that you cannot charge the estate for as a reminder, you may charge reasonable fees for preparing preparing your fee application, but you may not charge fees for defending the application. Finally, I just wanted to point out that the Bankruptcy Reform Act of 1994 required the program to develop guidelines for how we review the applications. And we published those fee guidelines in 1996. Obviously, the court has authority to award compensation. We are not trying to supplant the court. But the guidelines tell us how we will look at fee applications and generally impose standards and procedures that are articulated in Code Section 330 and Rule 316 for what's required for the application. And so you might want to review the guidelines, which are on our website. They might provide a helpful resource in how to draft and format the fee application. And that's all I have on compensation. Do you want to ask, especially about sub-fund trustee compensation? Here's your platform.
Compensation procedures. It's not unusual now where, in most cases, we are filing early in cases, but we're doing self-filed motions to establish compensation procedures that, by and large, adhere to those guidelines. And usually, the amount that we're requesting is the debtor pays $1,000 a month. It's depositing the trust account.
You're doing that as an active, you're filing
yes,
claims.
Yes, you're active filing motions. Getting those orders in the judges. Trustees to get paid. Cash collateral orders, it's already been mentioned earlier. We will object and point out to the debtor's counsel that there needs to be a line item budget for fees on monthly or and also on the dismissals.
I'll just add that nationally and anecdotally, the early returns are that trustee compensation is reasonable and the trustees are working well. Kudos to the U.S. Trustee.
We are on the next thing, which is Chapter 3. Chapter 5 or an individual debt.
Okay, so the bankruptcy threshold adjustments and technical correction act, BTATCA, was passed and came effective on June 22, 2022.
Yeah.
Maybe it was June 18th.
21st.
One of the major issues, in addition to the date of enactment, one of the major issues is how pronounced BTATAC. Batatic, Batic, and Judge Kahn, as I mentioned earlier in North Carolina, suggested back at it. So we will eventually get over that in the matter. But back at you established $7.5 million as the debt limit for Subchapter 5 for another 2 years, and it implemented a debt limit of $2,750,000 for Chapter 13 for 2 years. It is June 18th. $2.75 million for Chapter 13. So we have a significant increase in Chapter 13 eligibility, which means it becomes more important to be able to distinguish between whether a debtor is eligible for Chapter 13, should be in Chapter 13, or be in Subchapter 5. So that is what all of this is about, and we're going to talk about some of the differences between the two and why you might consider one as opposed to the other. There's already a question. It's June 18th.
Is that total debt, the 2.75 million, or is that broken down by securities?
It is no longer broken.
Okay.
For 2 years. The sun sets June 18th, 2024. Unless Congress extended. For 2 years, there's no distinction between secured and unsecured debts. And they still have to be only debts that are non-contingent and liquidated. Same rule we have now. So, my cohort on this part is Rob, who's going to talk to us about some of the structural issues involving differences in 13 and so forth.
And the devil's in the details here. This is where you really need to know your client's case. You need to know their income, their expenses, and you need to know the differences between the two. Because it can be a really close call which chapter you advise your debtor client to file. Of course, this is an individual case, but first, structurally, attorney's fees, the trustee fees. In the 13, generally, it's a fixed fee. Case can be done on an hourly basis, but by and large, the fees in the sub-5 case for an attorney are going to be much larger. It's just more work. So from that aspect, the attorney's fees are going to be higher in the sub-5 case than the 5-6. Also with the trustee fees. Trustee fees, as we've been saying, are hourly basis. From what I'm seeing, it's going to be more to file the sub-5 case as far as the trustee fees. Very seldom do I have a case where it's less than $5,000 in trustee fees. The fees for a Chapter 13 trustees are going to be, of course, the percentage of the disbursements to creditors, but I think by and large the fees will be more than $5,000 case. Next is going to be eligibility. To be eligible in the Chapter 13, all you really need under Section 1 is regular income, and then the debt limit. You've got to be below the 2.75 million. Oftentimes in a 13 where you'll have one spouse with regular income, sometimes you'll have a spouse that's unemployed, does not work. That spouse can automatically be eligible as well, just as long as one spouse has regular income. So in a sub-5 case, to be eligible as a debtor in sub-5, the debtor has to meet all the requirements of 1182A. So it's not necessarily the case that both spouses can file a sub-5 case. Next, another difference is going to be code debtors. called Chapter 13 that would come to interstate, where a non-filing spouse can be protected from collection activity on consumer debt, as long as that claim is paid in full of contract interest. Sub 5 does not have a coup to interstate. Next is going to be the plan. Chapter 13 plan. Every district is slightly different, but there's a model plan that's been approved by each district. And you can have a little deviation in what you do in that plan. The only real creative area where you can put some creative language is in the non-standard provisions. That's not so in a sub 5 case. Plans are going to be as simple or complex as the debtor wants to pay their attorney, basically, to draft. The form plan is the 425B form plan. It's very simple. It's 5 pages. I don't think it necessarily has enough, but you can put into a plan. I've seen plans that run over 30 pages, 5 pages of definitions. I don't know if it needs to be that complex as well. But there's a great range and flexibility as far as what kind of plan the debtor proposes to its creditors. A big consideration that you need to take into account when you counsel your clients and monthly operating is they're absolutely vital in the sub-5 cases out of sub-5. If you have a client that you don't think would be capable of filing monthly operating reports, they might need to do a 13. Because monthly operating reports are not required in 13. If those are timely filed, that could lead to the immediate dismissal or conversion of the case. And then finally, with structural changes, it was addressed earlier with voting. There's no voting in a Chapter 13, as everybody knows. Practices in that area. Silence, like you said, equals consent. You're a secured creditor. Doesn't matter what your proof of claim says. If you don't object to plan treatment, it doesn't give you adequate treatment. You're stuck with what's in the confirmation. But to get a consensual plan, we do need to round up those votes, as we discussed earlier. Now, one case out of that 10th Circuit that the judge referred to earlier, there is a sub-5 case, and I don't know if this is going to become, maybe some more circuits trying to get around this problem where creditors don't vote. But the Jaramillo case is a case out of that 10th Circuit. And it said as long as you can get one impaired class that votes in favor of the plan, if you have another impaired class where nobody votes, that silence will be consent. The site on that is 2022 Bankruptcy Lexis 2620 and 2022 Westlaw 438-9292. Seems to be a minority view of voting, but we'll see.
It's actually, it could be a majority view based on cases reported. But all the cases reported are bankruptcy decisions in, guess what, the 10th Circuit.
There's another sub-5 case out of there as well, same issue.
And they're all 10th Circuit cases.
All right, another consideration is PDI, and this is going to be with respect to unsecured creditors. Now, generally, I think in PDI, it's going to be more favorable to be in a sub-5 case. And anybody practices in the Chapter 13 realm knows where that's going to come in. It's going to come in with the dreaded means test for that CPA. PDI requirements in a sub-5 case just dig in and look at the statutes. First of all, PDI is inapplicable in a consensual claim. If creditors vote in favor of it, it doesn't matter what the objective disposal is. In a 13, if you're above the median, creditors, you have to pay creditors what that means test number says after factoring in what the current monthly
just for clarity, in a traditional Chapter 11 case, one creditor can invoke the PDI rule even if the unsecured class accepts. So that's another distinction. That is not the rule in a sub-5 case. It's a reason not to be in a traditional case or a small business case.
Now, if you look at the definition of disposable income, it's income that is received by the debtor, not reasonably necessary to be expended for the support payment of DSO obligations and business expenditures. And as I stated earlier, in 13, it's going to be current monthly income as defined under Section 101, that's the means test. Now, one key area that's different is going to be income. If you're in a Chapter 13, it's an individual case, the income of the non-filing spouse will go into the income column, as will payment of contributions to the household expenses. I don't believe the sub 5 definition of income necessarily picks up the non-filing spouse's income. There's the argument that can be made that it's income received by the debtor. Congress wanted to include the non-filing spouse's income and could have adopted a definition similar to what's been adopted in Chapter 13. Another thing you need to keep an eye on, too, is in the 13, though, you do have some income sources that are excluded from current monthly income. We don't know if that's going to be the case in the sub-5. In Chapter 13, Social Security income, VA disability, and income for alimony maintenance and support is not necessarily in the current monthly income category. I don't know if that's going to be the case in the sub-5. But those are pretty rare cases when you have somebody getting strictly those sources of income. Also, the means test. The means test standards do not apply in a sub-5. And I think you're going to look at case law that was there prior to BAP-CPA. BAP-CPA case law to determine what are reasonable and necessary expenses. And that could be an issue because there are some expenses under the means test that you can take that who knows if you're going to be able to take that in sub-5. Deductions for 401k, charitable contributions, mandatory payroll deductions. We don't know if those will be reasonable and necessary deductions. But by and large, I think that standard set forth in 1191B of disposable income would be a more relaxed standard of the means test. It's not unusual where you have clients that come in to do a Chapter 13, and their INJ show a number of 800 or 1,000. The means test shows a much higher amount just because they don't have children, for instance, and don't get all those deductions that seem to be geared towards households with children. So, I think by and large, a sub-5 would be a kinder standard than the ones across. Next is the plan term, too. Plan term in Chapter 13 is rigid statutory. If you're above the mean, you have to be in for 5 years unless you're paying 100% of the dollar that you're above. So if you're below the mean, the median, you have to be in for at least 3 years. There's more flexibility in a sub-5 case. The statute says at least 3 years, but no longer than 5 as the court will fix. And there are cases coming down on that issue on plan terms where U.S. trustee or creditors have objected wanting a longer plan term. I think most of those cases so far have basically said a 3-year plan term is sufficient. And courts have looked at number of reasons. First, because there are no statutory guidelines, they can determine 3 years as well. Another reason is that some courts have said, look, small businesses have a short shelf life. They're not around a long time. I don't want to lock the debtor into a 5-year plan. So for that reason, it seems like 3 years is going to be the standard. It's going to vary case to case. And if you are stuck with a ruling where it's a longer plan term, the case will also indicate you're going to have a tough time returning that decision on the field. It's a discretionary standard. Finally, prepayment. Flexibility in a sub-5 case, if you get that PDI amount fixed, that can be prepaid at confirmation. So that's a big advantage in a sub-5 case as well. And also I'm seeing provisions in sub-5 cases that allow for prepayment of the PDI amount. And that's flexibility that's built in the statute that you don't have in Chapter 13.
Questions so far? Did you have a question, Matt? you already know it all? All right, so I'm going to talk about treatment of secured claims and administrative claims. So we know the general rule of bankruptcy in Chapter 13, in particular, is, you know, plan, we pay, we figure out what the collateral is worth, and then we pay the value of the collateral over the term of the plan with interest at the infamous till rate. So that's the general rule in Chapter 13. There's debate in the traditional Chapter 11 cases about whether till governs the interest rate or not, not today to discuss. So there are exceptions to that rule in Chapter 13. There are two primary ones. One is a claim secured by a security interest only in real estate that is the primary principal residence of the debtor. And we know that under that, the anti-modification clause in 1322b2, we know that we cannot strip down a mortgage on the debtor's principal. We can strip it off if there's no equity, we can strip it off. But if there is 1 cent of equity, cannot modify that lien in the Chapter 13 case. Second, if we have a car purchased within 910 days of the filing, or other personal property purchased within a year and secured by a purchase by a security interest, we must treat that claim as a fully secured claim under the infamous hanging paragraph. And that means that interest must be paid on the amount of that claim. So those are the two exceptions to the bifurcation principle in Chapter 13 cases. Neither of those exceptions exists in a Subchapter 5 case. There is no hanging paragraph. I take that back. There's one of those exceptions does not exist. That's the hanging paragraph. No hanging paragraph. With regard to anti-modification of a mortgage on a residence, the rule is modified to permit strip down if the original loan proceeds were, one, not used primarily to purchase the property, and two, were used primarily for the small business of the debtor. So, think SBA mortgage, or SBA loan for the debtor's small business secured by a second mortgage on the debtor's residence. That's the type of claim we'll be talking about. Not used to purchase the property, money was went into the business. Under those circumstances, the claim can be stripped down to the value of the equity in the property. A major difference between Chapter 2. The flaw, the potential flaw in the slaw, as Virgil's case indicated, the creditor may have the ability to use the 1111B election in a Subchapter 5. The 1111B election is not available in Subchapter 13 because it only applies to the debtor. So that does limit the ability to strip down the mortgage in a Subchapter 5 case, but maybe the lender won't think about it. Because a lot of them don't understand. Okay, now, any questions about that? All right, so the other issue is to deal with administrative expense claims. Doing that, one other thing. There's also no requirement in Subchapter 5 that the secured creditor must receive equal monthly payment. So you don't have to have equal monthly payments in the Subchapter 5 case as you must have in Chapter 14. Now, priority claims. There is no deferred payment of administrative claims four priority claims permitted in the subchapter 5 case where it is a consensual claim. So if you, and or for that matter, where you have an agreement plan with regard to priority claims. Why could that potentially be important? You can't defer payment of a DSO claim in subchapter 5 unless in, and, okay, the other thing is, on tax claims, you can defer payment of priority tax claims over the term of the plan. You can do that in a subchapter 5 case with the caveat that the plan must provide for their payment within 5 years of the date of entry of the order for relief. And priority claims, tax claims in a sub 5 case or a traditional chapter 11 case for that matter, you must pay them with interest at the government rate. So chapter 13, you pay tax priority claims without interest and off you go. That is not the rule in sub chapter 5. The exception to payment of administrative claims on the effective date in sub 5 is in a cram down circumstance where they can be paid over the term of the plan. I submit that if you have a subchapter 5 trustee and debtors counsel who have fees incurred and they cannot be paid at the time of confirmation, but everybody else is in favor of confirming the plan, it would be my guess that in most cases the trustee and debtors counsel will agree deferral of their payments if they don't force them. So, as a practical matter, if you have to, you can probably defer professional fees in the essential case. The statute itself requires consent of professionals who are being deferred. That's it. Questions about that? I did a great job.
Thing I like to add to the IRS now is sending out letters in sub 5 cases as far as acceptable treatment on secured priority and unsecured claims. So you can count on the letter to give you the roadmap as to how to avoid an objection from the IRS.
One thing that I'll just throw in, like the judge said, on a non-consensual plan, yes, the professional compensation, including the trustees, can be stretched out. But I have had circumstances, especially early on with the statute,